Live from Tirana, Albania, Skanderbeg Square, with the great man statue right behind. I want to share with you my first impressions of Albania, first impressions of Tirana, and what the challenge were like getting here. So join me in this episode and take a little peek at what we've seen in the first couple of weeks. Coming to Albania in the middle of a pandemic, which is, some would say, my family included, insane, had some challenges. So I thought I'd share with those, what those were with you, and talk about how we overcame them. And in the end, you know, we got here and everything worked out okay. So we had sold basically everything that I owned before starting this trip back in the early part of the year, January through March. And once we had gotten rid of that, one of the last things we got rid of was the cars, which we were gonna go up to Washington, D.C., fly out from there for a couple reasons. One, the plane prices were much cheaper than flying out of East Tennessee. And then also because my sister-in-law was up there and my wife wasn't going to see her for about a year. And she wanted to spend some time with her sister before we left. And we kind of thought, you know, no problem. We just rent a car. I had rented cars back in January and February for small trips, even though I owned cars at the time. And, you know, they were $20, $30 a day, less if you rent them for the week. This is really cool. So they've got, it's in the middle of summer now, and they've got this thing called a Tirana cooling station. So we're gonna walk through and get cooled down and probably soak my waterproof camera. Oh, it actually works. Could spend some time in here. So, anyway, by the time we had left to go to DC, which we left in April of this year, I went to go and start renting cars. And I knew we were gonna have a challenge because it was gonna be a one-way trip. So basically, we would have to drop the car off in DC and wouldn't be bringing it back to Tennessee. And that does increase your cost, and it limits what rental agencies you can go through, pretty much to the majors. But the sticker shock when we got there and when I started looking around was just amazing. It was basically $200 a day to rent an SUV or a van to go on a trip. And that wasn't just to DC direct and leaving it. That was just to go local and drop it off at the same place. We were finding the same rates. And so what I found out was that there had been a change. So during COVID, the rental car places' business had collapsed. No one was traveling, kind of made sense. So they started selling off large sections of their fleet. Well, demand started coming back in April and May because people were traveling again. And they were down to about a third of the fleet they had before. And you know, prices follow demand. So still was gonna be cheaper to do that than to fly, especially with all the baggage we were gonna be taking. So this looks like a good place to sit and kind of chat. Neat buildings behind me. So I bit the bullet. I went ahead and reserved a van. Again, we had a ton of luggage because, you know, we were going away for a full year at a minimum on there. And basically everything that we owned was going to be traveling with us. We had to have clothes for winter. We had to have clothes for summer. So we were kind of doubling up. And there was four of us going because my adult daughter was going to travel with us for the first couple of months, see a little bit of Europe. And very loud cars. So when I got to the rental place, and I had specifically reserved a van because I knew we were going to need it for all that, we got there and the guy just laughs at me. He's like, "We haven't had a van in months. You can have this." And it was a little bitty SUV. It wasn't like a big SUV. And I was like, "Okay, I don't know if it's gonna fit." And he's like, "Either you want it or you don't want it, take it or leave it." Great customer service. Somebody having an emergency, I suppose. So we got the SUV. We were barely able to fit all of our stuff in there. In fact, we ended up having to leave some of it behind because we just didn't have enough room. If we'd had the van, it would have been fine. So we basically had to get rid of one piece of luggage that was gonna be going. So that was the first challenge in actually getting here. And that had, you know, I guess some implications because of the pandemic, but a lot of it was just the logistics of the rental car agency. So we get to DC and we're gonna go and take our flights to Albania. And Albania had no restrictions as far as entry. Moved down here where it's a little less noisy. But the airline that we ended up flying on, that we got our airline tickets through, was Lufthansa, which is a German carrier. I'd never flown them before. I'd flown a lot of different international carriers. Generally speaking, I like international carriers much more than I do American airlines or American flagged carriers. I find internationally they just do not hold up to the competition when traveling transatlantic, transpacific on there. But Lufthansa, because of the German government, had these crazy regulations as far as COVID goes. Now, we were vaccinated, but we still had to get tested 48 hours, not before we boarded the plane, but before the plane landed in transit in Frankfurt. So that really decreased the amount of time we had to take the PCR tests. We managed to get all those, tested negative. Again, we're fully vaccinated, and we get on the plane. And it was by far the worst international travel experience that I have ever had in all the years that I've been doing this. And it was for a couple of reasons. One, even though I'm fully vaccinated, everybody on the plane has tested negative for COVID within the last, you know, 24 hours because they had to take the test at least 48 hours before arriving on the ground in Frankfurt, and it's a 10-12 hour flight, something like that. We still had to wear masks. Now, they had us packed in there like cattle. I mean, there was not a seat that was open. But still, we had to wear masks the entire time. And not just any mask. You couldn't wear a cloth mask, you know, that, my God, might have some comfort to it and might allow you to breathe somewhat. But you had to wear a surgical mask or a N95 mask. And it's the entire time, other than when you're eating. Even though, again, everybody on the airline has tested negative for it, and many of us had been vaccinated, we still had to wear these masks. So, again, we chose to fly with them. We obey the rules. We did that. I may disagree with the logic on there. I think that you'd been much better off doing every other seat rather than packing people in like cattle than you would requiring the masks. But a lot of people weren't. So people would fall asleep on the airplane, and they had one stewardess, I guess she was the head stewardess, that she'd come around and she'd wake people up because their mask had slipped a little bit off of their nose. I mean, just the entire flight. It was like, you know, I don't know, East German Stasi come back to life. So the other problem with it was Lufthansa uses the Airbus, and I gotta admit, I'd never flown Airbus. For some reason, I've always ended up on Boeing products when I had traveled internationally, other than, can't remember if DC-10's Boeing or not. I'd flown some DC-10s back in the day when they were still around. But the seat configuration on the Lufthansa Airbuses is, quite frankly, disgusting. It is the smallest seat capacity I've ever seen on there. I mean, you are, it's like flying Allegiant in the United States. The seats are packed so tight. And you're not going to be on a plane for an hour or two going to Las Vegas or Florida. You're going to be on a plane for 10 or 12 hours crossing the Atlantic Ocean. So it's just absolute insane. I will never fly Lufthansa again or any other place that uses an Airbus with that configuration. I mean, I'll spend the extra few hundred dollars and fly a decent airline that I'm actually going to be comfortable with. So once we get into Frankfurt. Frankfurt, they've got the COVID protections in for transit. Every other seat in the waiting area is blocked off, sometimes two in a row, to keep people away. And I'm fine with that. You know, that's cool. But it was a weird experience. They had only one of the terminals open, so they closed down the other terminal in Frankfurt. And so they had only the original, I think, Terminal 1, which is a big airport, open because there's so many fewer flights during that period of time. I would say that 50% of the stores in the airport in the transit area were open, so that was nice. So you could get food, you could get, in fact, we bought a piece of luggage there because one of our carry-ons was an older one that had a blowout on there. But so, you know, there was things to do. It wasn't a bad transit place at all. And then we boarded our flight from Frankfurt to Tirana, Albania. Again, on a much smaller plane with Lufthansa, but the seat room was like twice as big. Even though it was a smaller hop, it was only going to be a 2 or 3 hour flight. The seat configuration was so much better and was so much more comfortable. So had a good flight with Lufthansa going from Frankfurt to Tirana. Get into Tirana, and we're at the airport. I just love how in Tirana you have these sidewalks, these walking streets. But motorcycles, when they don't feel the traffic builds up on the road, they just decide they're going to blow through here and make a bunch of noise too. Sorry about that. So going back, we get to the airport. We're checking in. I have an American passport. Again, my wife has a Filipino passport, which she doesn't have. Philippines doesn't have visa-free access to Albania, but she does through her green card in the United States for the 90 days. So I take mine and my son's passport in, go to the immigration, to the lady. She takes the passport, she looks at me, she looks at my son, sees that they match. She doesn't say a single word to me, doesn't ask me any questions, logs in the passports, does the same thing for my adult daughter. Then my wife goes up, of course she's coming in on a Filipino passport, and that's where the nervousness starts, because we had read online that we would be able to do this, but we couldn't find any government confirmation that she'd be able to come in visa free. And so immediately the same woman who checks us in starts asking her like tons of questions. And whereas they hadn't asked me a single thing. And she asks her like 10, 12 questions. She points over to me. Apparently she's explaining to them that that's her family. She's traveling with them. And then she punches her through, no problems. But at the time, we were kind of nervous because I was kind of like, well, maybe she doesn't get visa-free travel. Maybe this was just an internet rumor as much as we had explored it and tried to get official stuff. But anyway, so worked out great. Was very friendly in the customs and helped us out there getting through because we had a ton of luggage coming through. And so then we get into the country, and I give you my first impressions is that everything you see online from all these influencers, these YouTubers, and people that talk about the people of Albania and how friendly they are and how nice they are and how willing they are to help like travelers and stuff, that is 100% true. It is absolutely true. Out of all the places I've been in Europe, the people of Albania are by far the most friendly people that I have ever met anywhere in all of Europe. They've been incredibly helpful. If they see you and recognize them, they can tell you're a foreigner. I can now recognize, you know, the foreigners we kind of stick out like a sore thumb. But they see you confused, maybe you're looking around, they'll come over to try to help you to make sure that you don't need anything, or they can point you in the right direction. But everything you hear from all of those people is absolutely true. Absolutely the most friendly people that I've met in Europe. Hey, this is cool. So smile, we're in Albania. How funny. The other thing is Tirana is a very walkable city. Lots of stuff to see and do. And I think it's a really good place to go during these times. We're going to be here probably for about the full 90 days. We decided within a week of getting here that we really were going to stay, that we liked it, wanted to explore more, and especially wanted to get outside of the capital, which we'll do, and go to some of the other cities, such as Durres or Vlorë or Saranda, see some of the coast, and just basically use Tirana here as a home base to stay, to get some work done. I work remotely. My daughter works remotely. Also have some online businesses. So it's a good place to get that done. The infrastructure in Tirana has been perfectly adequate for my needs as far as doing remote work so far. And that's pretty much it. That's my first thoughts. That's the challenges that we kind of had getting here. It wasn't anything insurmountable, nothing like that. And so I'm glad that we picked Albania to start with. Again, wasn't our first choice to move here. We had originally wanted to go to Thailand and to Georgia. Thailand was locked down. Georgia wasn't allowing people from the Philippines to come in. So we ended up here in Albania, and I must say that I'm very happy with it. I like the Albanian people, and I really, really like Tirana. And so with that, I'll leave you here in Skanderborg Square with the summer festivities of playing in the water. And we'll catch you in the next one.